I just want to be the greatest. It's your boy High Five Vega back again, and this time we're going to learn how to design and build a ported enclosure. There are many, many ways available to us today to build, design an enclosure. You can use software on your computer from WinISD to Basebox Pro. There's websites that you can use to do this, and I believe it's sub.box.de or something like that. I can leave a link in the description below for that. But today, I'm going to show you the High Five Vega method. Now, it's going to be a little bit of new and a little bit of old, but it's all High Five Vega. So we're going to walk through my process, how I build an enclosure. And like I said, it's a little bit of new, a little bit of old. You guys can kind of mash it up. I'll try to show you some alternative methods on how to do this as we go along, so you can kind of find your own path. And it's going to be a long one. We got a lot of ground to cover, so get comfortable, get your drinks ready, and I hope you enjoy the process. The first thing we're going to need to do is measure the space. In the Suburban, I could pretty much build anything I want, so it's not an issue. But if you have a trunk, you need to measure not only the space inside the trunk, but the opening that you plan on getting the box through, whether it be through the seat fold down or the trunk opening itself. Bobby Gately done a good video on the trunk measurements, and I'll link it in the description below so you can check that out. Now we know how much space we had to work with, we're going to go to my favorite cardio related website, Basic Cardio Electronics. They have a sub box calculator. We can go in, enter our height, width, depth, and wood thickness, and it'll give us an internal volume. This is the simplest way to do it. You can do this with just pure math, but this is easy. It lets you play around with it, find just the right spot that you want to be at. I'm looking for a final volume after all the displacement of around 3.4, 3.5. I know this says 4.4, but we'll get to that in just a second. Now let's jump over to Mobile Information Lab's port length calculator. I'm going to use a slot port on this. I know that I want the enclosure to be around 3.5 after displacement. The tuning frequency I would like to be around 30 hertz. I know that the enclosure is 18 inches tall, so I'll subtract the top and bottom. That gives me 16 and a half. I want a 3-inch wide port. And now I calculate, and that gives me 35 inches. That's how long my port needs to be to get around that 30 hertz frequency that I want. So now we're going to go in and calculate how much space in the enclosure is this port going to take. This is where the 4.5 cubic foot comes in, because I had already done this calculation and I knew that we're going to take up roughly 1 cubic foot of box volume. If you wanted to be really old school, you'd take the height, the width, and the depth and divide it by 1728. That'll give you your volume, but where does 1728 come from? Well, if you take 12, multiply it by 12 again, and then multiply it by 12 once more, you come up with 1728. That is 1 cubic foot. So that's where 1728 comes from. That's how you get your calculations. I'm sure most of you knew this, but I bet you there's at least one of you that didn't know that. Now let's jump into my old school part. I like to draw these out by hand, so you know I have a little diagram of how I want to assemble it, and I'm also able to come up with my cut sheet, you know, just off the top of my head. You can do this all with software, but you know, I'm a bit of an old school guy, so I do crazy things like this, and if you want to, you can do it the same exact way. And now that I've got it all drawn out, I know how I want to assemble this. I want the top to be on top, the bottom to be on bottom, the sides to sit inside of the front and back. So this makes it easy for me to calculate what sizes I need. I know my top needs to be the full width and length, so I need 36 by 15 for the top and bottom. Now my front, I'm gonna have to subtract the 3-inch port as well as a 3/4-inch side, because on the port side I have the side piece coming all the way out, so you know that you need to subtract that from the overall 36 inches. So that gives us 32 1/4, and again it'll be 16 and a half inches tall because the top and the bottom do sit on top and bottom. The way this particular box is designed, one side will be 3/4 inch longer than the other. Now, the non-port side, the box side, will be 16.5 by 13.5. The port side needs to be 3/4 inch longer, so it'll be 14.25 by 16.5. I know that I wrote 14.5, but yeah, that was a mistake. It's 14.25. Now it's time to figure out how much port we need. We need 35 inches. It's gonna be 16.5 inches because that's the height of the face. I wanna use this labyrinth style that Obcon really made popular, you know, back in the early 2000s, late 90s. So you can go straight out the side. Whatever is easiest for you, go ahead and choose that route. When I done my calculations here, I did mess something up. I did not calculate the width of each board. So I need to go back and redo my calculations and make sure that I get this just right. If you're off by a couple inches on your port, it's not going to be horrible, but your tuning will be a little bit off. So it's not one of these things that's going to make or break your enclosure, but it's important to try to get it as close to your original vision as you can. This is why it's important to always double check your work before you start cutting any wood, before you start building. It saves you a lot of headache and a lot of heartache. You guys have seen me cut a lot of wood on this channel, so there's no need to go back through that, but I do want to kind of go through my assembly process. I like to set out all my pieces, get them in place. I like to set out all my tools and have everything within arm's reach. It really helps cut down the wasted time that you have out here in the shop. And if you're anything like me, you have other responsibilities. So the time that you're out here in the shop, you really need to make that efficient. And that's the best way to do it. Have a plan. And like our buddy Craig from Old School Car Audio says, plan your work and work your plan. As far as the assembly process goes, there are many different ways you can tackle it. I like to use a lot of glue and brad nails. You can use screws if you need something a little more heavy duty. If you do that, make sure that you pre-drill all the screw holes and countersink them. It's a lot of extra work, but it pays off in the end. You get a much nicer enclosure to cover, and you don't have to worry about messing with those screws too much or splitting your wood, because it's very, very important to pre-drill all the holes when you're doing that. You might be saying to yourself, hey, this isn't the enclosure we designed, and it's not. This is actually a 6.5 inch enclosure, but it was easier for me to show you assembly on this than the giant 15 inch box. So it's much the same on this enclosure than it is on that enclosure. But on this one, we have a little bit different port style. So we're gonna have to assemble an L on the port. And if you need to do that in yours, make sure that you assemble it outside of the enclosure. It just makes it so much easier. As we continue assembly, just make sure you're using enough glue. Spread it out with your finger, with a paintbrush, whatever you may be using. Also, make sure that you're checking your port width every step of the process. It's very important to maintain your port width. On this enclosure, it's 1 inch. On the enclosure we designed, it's 3 inch. So always, always check. Make sure you're marking your port on the bottom and top, so when you shoot your screws, you're not just shooting through the bottom or the top of the enclosure. That's a very key step in this whole assembly process. When I am checking my width, I always try to lock it in with a clamp when I can. That's not always going to be the case, but if you can use a clamp to maintain your port width perfectly, it's really a good thing to do, and it helps you out tremendously. Once you're pretty much assembled, it's always a good idea to go ahead and sand the top. That way you got a nice flat surface for your top to lay on, and you don't have to worry about any major gaps. Again, we've got the port marked out, so we know exactly where to shoot our pin nails. If you want to put some caulking in your enclosure, just make sure it's absolutely airtight. Now is the time to do that before you get the top on, and that way you get everything covered except for the top itself. One quick tip I forgot to mention was whenever you're cutting your wood, do all your roundovers right then before you start assembly, and just take some time to think about every part that needs to be rounded over. It really, really helps, and it's much easier than trying to do it while it's assembled. So here is the actual enclosure we just designed for the 15. You can do several different things to set this apart. Adding corner braces, not only does it help strengthen, it also helps you maintain that port gap so you have your 3 inches in every section of the port. Along with that, you can put actual braces in for the subwoofer mounting area itself. You can do a double baffle. You could do many different things when you're wanting to kind of customize your box to fit your own needs. As far as finishing out your enclosure, you can carpet it, you can paint it, you can rhino line it, many different options. It's just up to your creative mind and what you want to do aesthetically. Okay, now we need to pass wire through the box. We're not just going to run it through the port. You can use a terminal like I'm showing here. You can use bolts. You can even just pass wire directly through the box by drilling a small hole. That's it. That's basically how I design a ported enclosure. This is kind of a level 2 video for me. If you need something more beginner focused, I will link how to build an enclosure for beginners. That's my, you know, entry level box building video. So I will link that below, as well as Bobby Gately's How to Measure Your Trunk. That's a very good video. I'll also put a few videos from Mark from Car Audio Fab. Excellent, excellent videos. And I hope you guys enjoy this. If you want to see something even maybe more advanced, let me know in the comments if you have tips, what you do differently than I do. And yeah, I'll catch y'all in the next video. Shout out to all my Patreon supporters, but a special shout out goes to $6 or more members: 2001 Monolithic, The Third Era, Gene Nava, Joaquin Juarez, Paul Smith, Byron Chambliss, The Karate Guy, Jason Zemer, Travis McClendon, Brandon Hanna, William Berg, William Inhibit, and Mike Schneider. For as little as $2 a month, you can join the team and get exclusive patron-only content not available on YouTube. If you'd like to help me with my goal of reaching one new patron a month, check me out, patreon.com/highfivevega.